Namaparatas. Namaparatas, for example. And I argue about the second aparatus, parts are two meanings, one is a bit more dull and different from this form, qualities made, and the second one is the demigods. And I try to understand how that helpful of Twilight, because, for example, I have Christian or atheistic background, I have a lot of person from Russia or Europe, and it sounds strange because I've never thought about worship to demigods. And in the eighth apparatus, and it is the same moment about Tiana, Jana, Kamakanda, I think I also didn't think about Kamakanda, but if this apparatus are given in scriptures, it should be relevant for every country and period of time. And the second part of the question is the second meaning of its apparatus. Your mind should be very to pay a lot of attention to the holy name. But for example, Shiva is a Pakistan's Vatitakur said in his Upadeshavali 24th that don't worry if your mind is restless, and it's like two different parts. It's offense if your mind not calm, but you should be patient when your mind.
Three questions, three misconceptions.
Три вопроса, три misconceptions.
Oh, you want to? Oh, you said in English. Yes. Okay, translate.
Вопрос насчет нам-аппарат, второй нам-аппарат. Я не понимаю, одно из значений, второй нам-аппарат, если при этом не считают, что полубоги выполняются полубогами, не считают игроком Кришнана. И мой вопрос был в том, что для людей из России и Европы это кажется на первый взгляд не очень важно, потому что у нас христианский или такой атеистический как бы фон мировоззрения. Непонятно, как это относится к нашей жизни. То есть я никогда не думала до этого раньше про поклонение полубогам. И, например, восьмой нам аппарат про Яну, Карму, не приравнивать как Макану, и мне также не думала про свершение Карму, ритуалов Карму. Но если это сказано в шастрах, значит, это должно быть важно для любой культуры и любого периода времени. Да, и вторая часть вопроса, что восьмой нам аппарат сказано, что это оскорбление, если мы не должны беспокоиться во время джапы и гулять по всей Вселенной. Но в то же время, например, чем баптистизация, такой группа говорит, что мы должны быть просто терпеливыми, если мы постоянно бродим туда-сюда. То есть как примирить это? С одной стороны, это оскорбление, с другой стороны, это единственный путь.
First of all, the question is that why is the second offense to the holy name is concerned with not equating the demigods with the supreme lord? So she's saying, I am from Christian culture, so we don't have any demigods. So the Vedas should be universal, and they shouldn't say irrelevant things. But actually, now you are chanting Hare Krishna daily, and you have, because you have entered into Vedic culture, so it immediately becomes relevant. I cannot see any fully dedicated Christians who have not entered into Vedic culture, who are chanting Hare Krishna all day.
Но все равно, вы говорите, матушка Хари Кришна таким образом вы уже вошли в контекст ведической культуры. Нельзя говорить, что она не относится к нам.
So this is a hypothetical problem, not actual problem.
То есть это такая гипотетическая проблема, не настоящая.
Secondly, actually, even in Russia and so many places, the indigenous religion before Christianity believed in so many gods.
И на самом деле, до Евразии и многих других европейских стран, до реформы христианства было язычество, и там люди верили в целый культов богов.
And that's true everywhere.
Это относится ко всем практическим культурам.
Then, this verse means Diyabhinna Pasit Sakalu Harinama Hitakara. It means it's an offense to think that the name and form and qualities of Lord Shiva are independent of the Supreme Lord Vishnu's names.
Вот эта вторая намаправатика означает, что оскорблением является думать, что имя, качество Господа Шивы независимы от Господа Вишну.
So here, Diyabhinna means it's offense to see that there is a Daya, Abhinna, they are separate. And it's also offense to see that they are not separate. Here, this is Dia Abhinna, Dia Bhinna, both meanings are. So it means sometimes the Shiva is Shiva Tattva. And he's not equal to Vishnu. But sometimes Shiva is Vishnu Tattva, Sadashiv. So then he is Vishnu. So it is offense to see, to make them equal if they are not equal. And it is offense to not make them equal if they are equal also.
В том случае, если они не равны, и наоборот, если мы их не приравниваем, если они равны, ну, в случае садашивы.
And also by Lakshanabriti, it is Shiva here also includes other devatas.
И по Лакшанабрити также Шива здесь включает других полубогов.
In other words, there can be a tendency. And this is where it applies to someone from monotheistic Christian or Jewish or Islamic background.
Может быть такая тенденция, и в данном случае поэтому это может быть применимо к людям с монотеистическим бэкграундом, кто верит в единого Бога, в христианстве, в исламе, в иудаизме.
Those who are very fanatically monotheistic.
То есть есть люди, кто очень так фанатично монотеистичны.
Then they can easily accept, oh, Krishna is Supreme Personality of Godhead.
Им легко принять, что Кришна верховная личность Бога.
But then they disrespect the devatas. Your tendency, according to your conditioning, will be to disrespect devatas.
И тогда вот в этом нашем условии, в нашем контексте, мы будем, у нас будет тенденция не уважать полубогов.
Ah, who is Shiva?
Oh, Shiva.
Durga, Ganesha. Like this. But this is offense.
Но это оскорбление, так не будем жить так.
Because they're also the servants of Supreme Lord. And Supreme Lord is absolute, so they are parts, especially the material devatas in the material world, are parts of the universal form of the Lord.
Материальные девы, материальная вселенная, это части вселенской формы Господа.
Our philosophy is Achintya Bheda Bhed.
Наша философия Achintya Bheda Bhed.
So if one will have extreme Bhed, but without a simultaneous Abhed, then one will be stuck in dualistic thinking.
То есть если у кого-то будет
So we cannot say that it's not relevant.
Поэтому мы не можем сказать, что это вторая намаправка, но не относится к нам.
And if it were not relevant, it wouldn't make any difference.
Но даже если бы она к нам не относилась, это было бы все равно не важно.
Because not everyone is making all the offenses. And if that offense were not there, then there's millions and millions of people for whom it is relevant, and then the description would not be complete. But anyway, it's hypothetical. There's no one who is seriously taking shelter of Hare Krishna mantra who is not, doesn't, has not developed a faith in the Vedic culture. Because also, that is Gurava Gya Shuti Shastra Nindanam, to criticize the Vedic scriptures. So if someone is thinking, I believe in Krishna, but I don't believe in any devatas, they don't even exist, then this becomes now criticism of Vedic scripture, another offense to the Holy Name. And it will become a Guru Avagya. Because there's no guru who teaches that Lord Shiva does not exist or any devotees. So it is very relevant. Then the other one that you mentioned is irrelevant. Dharma Bharata Tyaga Hutari Sarava Shubhakriyam Samyam Api Pramada. First part explains that it's an offense to equate dharma, vrata, tyaga, that means performing vows, renunciation, and huta, the performance of fire sacrifices, with the chanting of the Holy Name.
Следующая нам обратка, которую мы упомянули, это то, что оскорбительно приравнивать дхарму, брату, тягу, совершение дхармы, это отречение с воспеванием святых имен.
So you cannot, also if you are from another culture or Christian background, you cannot say it's irrelevant.
Но также, если вы из христианской культуры, религии или какого-то другого background, то вы не можете говорить, что это к вам не относится.
Because in all the religions of the world, they promote doing pious activities.
Потому что во всех мировых религиях говорится о том, что нужно совершать благочестивую деятельность.
So it's not uncommon that a person, say, from a monotheistic background or Christian background, will think that feeding the poor people and making a hospital, this is all dharma, doing welfare activities, is that's just as good as chanting Hare Krishna.
Поэтому вообще достаточно часто люди с христианским бэкграундом или с бэкграундом какой-то другой религии могут подумать, что строить больницы, помогать бедным, кормить их, это так же хорошо, как воспевать святые имена.
And doing brats, doing austerities. There are some persons, they do flagellation, you know, they whip themselves to try to get in the mood of Jesus. So they're doing some austerities. Oh, many religions also have a lot of fasting. And so if you think that all of this is really, really good, this is as good or better than chanting Hare Krishna, then it becomes offense. So it's not only Vedic culture specific, it's also universal. Then the offense api pramada, inattentiveness. So you mentioned Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur is saying, if while you're chanting, then you have irrelevant thoughts are coming. He said, it's not that he said, don't worry about that. Just keep thinking the irrelevant thoughts. He didn't say. In Gita, Krishna said, from wherever to wherever the mind wanders, when you are trying to meditate, then you should bring it back.
Кити Кришна говорит, что где бы ваш ум блуждал, когда вы стараетесь воспевать, вы должны постараться его вернуть обратно.
So it's not true that Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur said, if you're chanting and you're thinking about the things, it's okay.
Поэтому неправильно понимать, что Шрила Бхактисиддханта Сарасвати Такур говорит, что если вы воспеваете ваш ум где-то вроде, то это в порядке вещей.
He said that you are trying to concentrate, but unavoidably, due to the conditioned state, sometimes these thoughts will come. Don't be discouraged. Be persistent. Try again and again.
Он на самом деле говорит, если вы стараетесь воспевать внимательно, но поскольку мы в условленном состоянии, неизбежно будут приходить какие-то мысли, и он говорит, не сдавайтесь, пусть это вас не обескураживает, просто продолжайте пытаться.
So there is two types of inattentiveness. One is deliberate.
Один это такой осознанный невнимательность.
And the other one is unavoidable due to one's conditioned state.
А другой вид невнимательности тот, который неизбежен, поскольку обусловлен нашим обусловленным состоянием.
Because in the conditioned state, before nishtha especially, the mind is unsteady.
Потому что в обусловленном состоянии до уровня нишки ум нестабилен.
So you cannot control it very expertly. But you have to try. And if it wanders, bring it back. So the unsteadiness of the mind or inattention which arises due only to one's conditioned nature against one's will is not aparad. This is not aparad. And one's chanting is categorized as a namavas. So, and the inattentiveness, which is deliberate. While I'm chanting Hari Nam, I am making a shopping list. And planning something and doing so many things instead of hearing the holy name, deliberately. So this inattentiveness is the apparat. Don't think Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur is saying, if you're doing this, it's fine. No. In Jagadharma, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur explains that there are two types of obstacles in chanting. One is called sadharan vigna, ordinary obstacle, and the other is called vishesh vigna, intense obstacle.
В Джайнадхарме Шрила Бхактисиддханта Тхакур говорит, что есть два вида препятствий. Садхара Вигна – обычное препятствие, и Вишеш Вигна – это какое-то особенное препятствие.
So when that is applied to the subject matter of inattentiveness.
И когда мы применяем это к вопросу невнимательности.
So the inattentiveness that comes just due to the natural imbalance of mind in the conditioned state is called Sadhara Vigna, ordinary obstacle, and it's not an offense, and one's chanting can be nam abhas. And if there's deliberate inattentiveness, then it becomes vishesh vigna, intense obstacle, and that is nam aparad. Good. Good question, thank you.
Хороший вопрос, спасибо.
How to feel in the deep bhakti?
Можно проще.
Как почувствовать и сохранить бхакти? How to feel it?
Bhakti Shakti is not a material energy. So it is not anywhere in this material world. But Bhakti Devi uses pure devotees as her vehicle to move around the world. So Bhakti Devi is only with the saints, with the sadhus. And we can experience that by sadhusanga. Then how can one keep that experience? for that, the instructions that the sadhus are giving, that Gurudev is giving, we have to be fully surrendered to the following those instructions. We make a connection with the spiritual energy by seva, seva vritti, by serving under the guidance of those who are already under the control of that bhakti shakti. So at first it's quite difficult. Because when you are in association, that time you will feel the power of bhakti, and then when you go out of association, then you go, oh, what happened to me? Because the effect is not lasting. But the impressions are lasting. And so if you focus on hearing, chanting and remembering when you're not in association, those impressions will stay with you and become stronger. And the spiritual impressions will overpower the material impressions, which causes to engage in worldly activities and worldly thoughts and conceptions. After some time, the spiritual impressions become stronger and stronger, and everything about devotional service will become natural. Then when your practices are Nyabhilashta Shunyam Jnanaka Martinavitam Anukulyena Krishna Nushalam Bhakti Uttama without any worldly desire. Not mixed with karma, jnana, yoga, tapasya and everything. And when your cultivation is continuous and uninterrupted. And in Anugatya under guidance of Guru. Then the bhakti shakti will appear in your, first in your mind, and then in your senses. So all the things you are doing, try to follow it after some, you are experiencing bhakti because you have some taste, and you are making so much sacrifice. But to keep that experience with you, you have to follow very carefully, and it will take some time before that pervades you. So the example is given of putting iron in a fire. Iron is cold and grey. But if you put it in a fire for a minute and then you take it out, it's a bit warm. But it's still grey. And a minute later it became cold again. If you put the iron in the fire and you leave it there for 1 hour, then when you take it out, then it's bright red. And it even can set fire to other things. So it takes some time of association and absorption that the energy of bhakti becomes from our guru parampara transferred to us, and then we become the vehicle for that bhakti shakti.
Could you explain the main difference between Jnana Marg and Yoga Marg?
Jnana Marg has for its goal mukti, liberation.
Гьяна Марг значит для пункта освобождения.
And the realization of Brahman.
И осознание Брахмана.
Йог Садан has for its goal, initial goal, realization of Paramatma.
Йога Садана, ее первая цель, это осознание Параматмы.
And then the yogis can either from Paramatma realization go into bhakti, or they can merge with Paramatma and attain mukti.
И затем у йогов уже есть выбор, они могут двигаться либо в сторону бхакти, либо в сторону мукти.
So then in the end it's the same.
И тогда в конце будет один и тот же.
It's a non-experience, Sayujya Mukti.
Это вне опыта, отсутствие опыта, Sayujya Mukti.
But technically, the Jnani's Mukti is Brahma Sayujya, and the Yogi's Mukti is Ishwara Sayujya. But in the end, they experience it as the same. One is merging with Brahman, one is merging into Paramatma, and then experiencing Brahman.
То есть, технически, это два таких аспекта. У Jnani это Brahma Sayujya, это слияние с Brahmanом, а у йогов это...
Yes, yes. So the Jnana Marg has 20 angas. Like our Bhakti Marg has 64 angas, Jnana Marg has 20 angas. Amanitvam dambitvam ahimsakshanti ajavam macharupasamam socham staram atmavinigraha. Indriyateshu vairagyam anahankara evacha janma mrityu jarajapriyadi dukudoshanu dashanam. Like this, 20 angas are described in chapter 13, Bhagavad Gita. So these angas include being free from pride, being truthful, serving your acharya in Jnana Marg, controlling the senses, being detached from worldly life, not being entangled with family and society, being attached to living alone, vivikta-desha sevitvam, engaging your mind in the thoughts of discrimination between matter and spirit. So you can see Krishna is giving these 20, in all 20 angas of Jnana Marg in chapter
13.
Whereas the Yoga Sadhana has some similarities. But they have Yam, Niyam, Asana, Pranayam, Pratyahara, Dharan, Dhyan, Samadhi, 8 limbs.
Там есть 8 таких анг тоже. Яма, Ньяма, Асана, Пратихара.
So the Jnani is not necessarily doing yoga asanas or pranayama.
То есть Jnani не обязательно вот это все делает из йога асаны.
He may be more inclined towards the tapa austerities and philosophical study, Sankhya.
И может быть больше нравятся аскезы или философские изучения там Sankhya.
But mainly, these generally persons practice some mixture of both. So the paths of karma, jnana and yoga that Krishna describes in Bhagavad Gita are complementary. It's a question of emphasis. Pradhanyam Vyapadesha means that the name is given to that practice which is prominent. So if you're doing a little bit of yoga but a lot of Jnana Yoga, then you're a Jnani. If you're doing a lot of yoga but a little bit of Jnana, then you're a yogi. So the name is given according to which practice is predominating, because there's much overlap also. But the thing about the path of Jnana Yoga, if you want to try to attain perfection through Jnana Yoga, then you have to be in the renounced order.
Если вы хотите обрести совершенство через гьяна йогу, то вы должны быть в отречении.
You cannot be in the, have a job or a family or anything. You have to go and live alone in a cave in the mountains somewhere.
Вы должны жить в пещере один. У вас не может быть ни семьи, ни работы.
Whereas Ashtanga yoga can be practiced by anyone.
Ashtanga yoga может практиковать любой.
So, because the detachment, renunciation, is extremely difficult for the conditioned souls.
Поскольку отречение очень сложно для условленных душ.
In Gita, Sri Krishna does not recommend the Jnana yoga. But Sri Krishna recommends Karma Yoga supported by the Dhyana Yoga or Ashtanga Yoga. Because if a person renounces everything and then their sankskaras are still strong, they have no weight. By Dhyana Yoga, it will not be powerful enough to overcome the urges of the senses. So Sri Krishna recommends that a person should be in his position in Varnashram Dharma. And perform his duties in life but without attachment to the results. And by doing this, his mind will become steady and jnana will arise by itself. So Sri Krishna said that those who think that the path of karma and the path of jnana are different, they are in ignorance. Because jnana will come by performing karma without attachment to the result. And because the senses are engaged with the world in duties, they become controlled. Whereas the person who just takes the sannyas and leaves all the duties and tries to control his senses by his mind, then it's very difficult because his senses have no engagements.
Потому что и более того, чувство человека, который занят кармой, он их задействует в выполнении долга, и таким образом они под контролем. А если человек на пути гьяны ничего не делает, никак не задействует свои чувства, и просто пытается их контролировать, это ему намного сложнее даже.
So then, the person who is doing the karma yoga and following his duties every day, in the morning and the evening, he can sit and he can do some asana and pranayama and pratyahara. And by yoga sadhana, it will complement the stability of mind which is developing from his performance of duties without attachment. So the two will work together synergistically to help him more radically attain jnana.
И вот так, например, человек, который занимается своими делами, да, путем карма-йоги, он может утром и вечером совершать яма-нияму, он может садиться и совершать какую-то йога-садхану, и это ему поможет успокоить ум и тоже обрести гьяну.
And then Sri Krishna describes the best path is bhakti yoga.
А затем Кришна говорит, что лучше будет это бхакти йога.
Now the question comes. If bhakti yoga is the best, and Krishna said, sarva dharmam parityaja, leave all the dharmas and just surrender to me, then why did he spend so much time explaining the karma, jnana and yoga? And the reason is this, that the Bhagavad Gita is for everyone. So, everyone can be divided into two categories. Those who have sadhu sangha and those who don't. Because bhakti yoga is not a karma, it's not a physical exercise. It's not. Bhakti depends on sraddha, faith.
Bhakti is not a physical exercise, it's karma.
And this faith that Krishna is Supreme Personality of Godhead and we are His servants is nirgun. So in this world no one has it and no one can get it even. Only it is contagious from the sadhus. If you have the chance to meet a sadhu, then they impart that nirgun sraddha into the heart, bhakti lata beach.
Но это вера заразна. Если вы встречаете саду, то он поделится с вами этой верой.
So only those persons who have sadhu sangha and receive that shraddha, they are the adhikaris. They can be, if the shraddha is soft, they are konishta adhikari, komala shraddha. If the shraddha is firm, then they are madhyam adhikaris, but they perhaps don't know shastra so deeply. And if the shraddha is very strong and they have deep shastric knowledge, then they are uttam adhikaris. But whatever adhikari it is, it's based on the development of shastriya shraddha that comes from sadhu sangha. So what about those persons who have not yet met with the pure devotee? What do they do? So there's karma, jnana and yoga. Those who are very much detached from this world. They have adhikar for jnana yoga. And those who are attached to this world, they have adhikar for karma yoga. So, those who are very detached from the world, they are very rare person. So, for the most people, they should do karma yoga and they can supplement that with ashtanga yoga and slowly, slowly their jnana will arise. This jnana means the dayatma buddhi vivek, the discrimination between soul and body, that is jnana. And by this way, at least they can gradually make progress through the gunas until the opportunity comes to meet the sadhu. So that's an overview of the whole Gita. Right? Two types of people. One who has sadhu sangha can do bhakti. And for those who have not had that association, it's better to do the karma yoga and support it with the ashtanga yoga. And the jnana yoga is extremely difficult. If one, because to be renounced while the senses are not fully controlled is a dangerous position. Is this clear? One more question.
Сейчас Бхатаджи Махарадж объясняет космологию, и при этом он говорит, что материальная природа на самом деле она ачинтия. И хотелось бы понять, как преданным воспринимать видимую разницу между описаниями Бхагаватам и видением современных ученых, и каким образом нам это знание преподносить людям со стороны, которые спрашивают об этом.
So now Balaji Maharaj is explaining the cosmology, and he's saying that material nature is achintya, and how should the devotees consider the difference between the shastric description of the world and and what scientists say, and how shall we explain it to other people who are not devotees who are asking?
If a person is not devotee, then you should tell them that they are not the body. And chant Hare Krishna. There's no reason to go into the fifth canto, even they did not read the first, second, third and fourth. Why bother to go to the Another thing is that there are different perspectives on the world, adi-daivik, adi-bodhik and adi-atmik. So adibotic is the perception of the world of the gross physical elements. From our perspective. Then there is adidaivik. It's perspective of the devatas. They have different constitution of body and mind and senses. So their experiences are different. So when you see the description of the Bhumanda, the plane of the earth, so many different areas are described, like Kim Purusha Varsh. So we cannot experience these places. These are superior beings. And so Shukadeva Goswami is describing what he's seeing in his trance. And it is from an adidaivik perspective, as devatas can see the universe. You cannot imagine how devatas experience. If two people are having a fight, so one person is punching the other, and the other one is trying to punch him. But actually for Indra, then who is winning? Because Indra is in control of the hands of both persons. Indra is conscious of the hands of everyone. For him, they are under his control. So same with other devatas. Surya Devi is controlling your eyes. Agni Devi is controlling your voice. See, these are not the experience of the demigods. What it means to be a devata is not within our human experience. So you should think in this way, that what Shukadeva Goswami said is not fictional. But different jivas, according to their piety or impiety, take birth in these different realms. So if you have enough material piety to be born in the Bhuvalok with the Siddhas, Charanas, Gandharvas, you'll experience the planet of the Gandharvas and of the Siddhas and everything. If you have the karma to be a Kinara. Do you know what Kinara is? Kinara has a body like a horse and then the front part like a human being. So we would say in our Western culture, Sagittarius.
Yes, yes, then we know the reason for it.
Yes. So these beings exist. But you have to go to Kinaralok. So the ancestors of the people in Western culture, they saw these beings and they have described them. But now the piety is so down in Kali Yuga, we think it's not true.
И раньше в западном, даже предки людей в западной культуре современной их видели, и поэтому описывали, и мы знаем, поэтому такие кентавры. Но сейчас уровень благочестия совсем упал, и поэтому мы уже не знаем, кто это.
So you should take the description to be a description of different planes of existence and different places which are real and can be accessed in accordance with one's karma. And if you don't have that karma, then you cannot just buy a ticket and go by a train to that place.
Поэтому мы должны понимать, что описание, которое дано в шастрах, это реально существующее описание различных мест. Просто у вас может хватить благочестия и увидеть или нет. И если нет, то вы не можете просто взять туда и купить билет на поезд и поехать.
One more question to report today.
One was deity worship or deity darshans and all that stuff, and on the other side was hearing chanting. And you had said one is independent and the other is work together or something like that. So if one is not inclined towards this which is the dependent one. So what should they put effort in developing that?
Ранее вы говорили о том, что можно просто заниматься воспеванием святых имен и слушанием, и это независимые такие ангелы. А можно параллельно с этим совершать божества, заниматься служением божества. И вот это зависит от слушания и повторения святых имен. То если нет, so if you don't have the taste to the...
If they don't have the taste for a deity worship, then should we really focus on the taste or hearing chanting alone is sufficient?
Если у человека нет вкуса к тому, чтобы просто, ну, к тому, чтобы поклоняться божеству, может ли он тогда просто чистой совестью совершать воспевание святых имен?
The question has some faults.
Yes, it's the end of the person.
Because it's not based on clearly understanding what I said.
Не совсем правильное понимание того, что я сказала.
The context of the discussion was how does one get the eligibility for Raghunuga Bhakti?
Контекст вопроса был такой, как можно получить квалификацию для Raghunuga
Bhakti? It was not a discussion whether we should serve the deity or not serve the deity.
То есть вопрос не стоял, как можно божеством служить или нет.
So, the eligibility for Raghunuga Bhakti is lobh, greed.
Квалификация для Raghunuga Bhakti – это лобх, жадность.
So, in Bhaktivinoda Sindhu, in one place it said this greed comes from hearing. And in another place it said this greed comes from hearing and taking darshan of the deity. So you cannot go to Mangalarti and not take darshan of the deity unless you are blind. So every day, morning arti, evening arti, noon arti, we're having darshan of the deity. So it's not a question, the discussion is not whether to serve deities or not serve deities. It is that greed can come to the person who hears and who sees the beautiful decorations of the deity. It stimulates his greed to experience the sweetness of Krishna's form. So these two statements are there in Bhaktivinoda Sindhu. One, greed comes from hearing. One, and two, greed comes from hearing and having darshan of the sweetness of the form of the deity. So then in the commentaries, Jiva Goswami and Srila Vishnupad say that the reason hearing was told alone by itself is because it has independent power to awaken greed.
Шрила Джива Госвами и Шрила Вишванатха Чакрабарти Такур говорит, что слушание указано отдельно, потому что у него есть независимая сила проводить жажду.
And the reason darshan of the deity and hearing have been told together is to show that these two can be, the two together can be the cause of greed, but seeing the deity, only seeing the deity has not been given as a cause of greed by itself because it is not independent of hearing. If you only see the deity, greed will not come. You have to hear and see the deity. So the topic is, how does one get the eligibility for Raghunuga Bhakti, the awakening of greed? That's the topic. Now, the topic of should I engage in any worship of the deity or participate in the deity's program in the temple, whether it's with kirtan and darshan and all these things? That's another question.
Mm-hmm.
That is, should I follow the archan? path of Archan? And the answer is, for the Kanishtha Adhikari, Archan is absolutely essential. That's the definition of the Kanishtha Adhikari. Archaya evaharaye pujaya sadayate natat bhakteshu chanyesu sa bhakta prakita smritaha. The neophyte devotee, Kanishtha Adhikari, that means up to the stage of Nishtha, then they are characterized by having faith in the deity and the path of Archan. And they see, they have faith, they see God in the deity and they see God in their guru also. But the thing that makes them Kanishtha Adhikari is they don't see God anywhere else, like in other devotees. God is only in my guru and in the deity, but not in other people. So Natat Bhakteshu Channeshu, therefore they don't know how to properly associate with and interact with other devotees and other and general people also. So the deity is very important for Kanishtha Adhikari to make a strong samskar of Krishna group. So if you have a deity in your home also, you should not have a deity which is this big. Because it's not sufficient to make the samskar of the rupa in the heart. That it should be, it can be like, but like not small than this. If it's small like this, it will not be so effective. Yes, another question. Radhika. Radhika.
Значит, позавчера мы слышали, что когда Джива дает тонкое тело, грубое тонкое тело, другое, тут же предыдущее тело умирает. Вопрос, если это Джива заслужило человеческое тело, то в большинстве случаев это тело будет каким-то образом предыдущего отношения. То есть из людей, с которыми уже были отношения, то есть семьи, семейные отношения, которые являются местами, например, прочее. Почему я задаю этот вопрос? Потому что регрессивные гипнозы почти всегда сделаны автистическим способом, то есть серьезно, показывают, что связь была с предыдущими людьми и повторялась.
So we heard about when a person dies, then the subtle body and the gross body, if the person deserves a human body by karma, then they acquire a new body. And Radhika is making reference to a lot of regression studies, study past lives, and make some hypnotic studies also, that very often the person gets a body of which is somewhat related to their previous family members, that now they will also be somewhat together.
Mm-hmm. First of all, there are no studies which can confirm what happens after a person's death, because when a person has died, then you can't talk to them and find out what happened. So many ideas are coming from the near-death experience. So what the person had in their near-death experience, then they came back, that was not death. So we cannot say that this is 100% valid or reliable evidence, because they actually didn't die.
Но они вернулись обратно. Но дело в том, что мы не можем сказать, что у них было бы смерть, потому что это не была смерть. То есть там это не 100% валидный опыт у них.
So whatever you are attached to in your life, in the last moment you will think of that. So if someone had a near-death experience, and then they felt they were leaving their body and they saw their grandmother and all these things, but then they came back, that doesn't mean that that's where they were going. It just means that that's what they were thinking in that final moment. Not final moment, but almost. So, for example, Bharat Maharaj in the last moment thought of a deer. But that doesn't mean that he went in his next life to be with that particular deer. He just became a deer. Doesn't mean that he became that deer. So, it's natural that the conditioned souls have very strong attachment to their family. So on the path of karma, there are yagyas that you can do in your life. So that when you die, you go to a planet called Pitrilok. And then your children, they can do the same yagyas, and when they die, they'll go and be with you. And because life here is short, but life there is very long. So you can have many generations of your family living together in the Pitrilok. So it's not impossible for a person to go and join their ancestors. It's one of the desires that people have, and because the Vedas are a desire tree, the Vedas give a method by which you can fulfill that desire. But for the general people who don't follow the yagyas for the pitris to attain the planets of the ancestors, then when they die, even if they think of some relative, then it just means they'll get a body which is similar to that relative, but not, but that relative has already years before left that body and taken birth somewhere else, maybe not even human, we don't know, or demigod, could be anywhere, but then you'll get a body corresponding to what you were thinking, remembering them, but perhaps they were remembering something else, so they go somewhere else and you go somewhere else.
Но если мы не совершаем вот эти вот яги, чтобы отправиться на Петрилок, то, скорее всего, когда ну, просто человек умирает обычный, и в последний момент он думает о каком-то своем близком родственнике, то он, возможно, получит тело, которое просто очень похоже на тело этого близкого родственника. Но если этот родственник уже сам давно умер, он уже давным-давно, возможно, думал о чем-то другом, принял совсем другое воплощение, даже не факт, что человеческое. То есть мы не можем так ничего гарантировать.
And the attachment to the physical family in this world is the not attachment to the soul. If you actually saw the soul in one person, you would see the soul in everyone, and you would see everyone the same. Only you've seen the body, so you're thinking that this one is like this, very special and important to me. So in Gita, Sri Krishna said, Vidya Vinaya Sampane Brahmani Gavi Hastiniti Shuni Chaiva Swapakacha Panditaha Samadarshinaha. That a person who is a pandit sees equally an elephant, a cow, a dog, an outcast person, or a high class Brahmin, sees everyone equally. Krishna was saying this yesterday, we told, to his father. In Gyan Mark, you see Atma and Paramatma in everyone. And you never discriminate between one person or another. But in Karma Mark or Dharma, then neutral persons, you think they're enemies. And your own family members, you accept them as your Atma. Because you have duty to them that you must do. And bhakti is the best. Because in bhakti, actually, though you know all the souls, you see them all equally, but you have more attachment to each person depending on their devotion to Krishna. So there's no need to be detached from your family if your family are all devotees. Because we should not be detached from devotees. But the relationship should be in proportion to each person's devotion to Krishna, not their physical and mental psychological attributes, which are material. So, whatever conclusions, whatever studies, whatever stories or experiences are told by conditioned souls, we don't put our shraddha in that. If anyone had hallucination when they almost died and came back, this is not proof of what will happen afterwards. Because actually they didn't leave. So our praman is Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. What the scriptures are saying, as explained by the Guru Parampara. And if any other type of study or experience supports that, we accept it. But not because of the methodology of that thing, but only in the sense that it's supporting Vedic literature. And if it contradicts it, then we don't accept it. Because all conditioned souls have four defects. Imperfect senses. The tendency of to be biased according to their own desires. People tend to see the things that they want to see. Then mistakes due to illusion. And also the mistakes that arrive, or the lack of understanding, the inability to comprehend something due to the restlessness of the mind, inattentiveness. So because all conditioned souls have these four defects, they're incapable, they are not sufficiently endowed with the instruments to actually gather accurate knowledge about anything. So actual knowledge comes from Shabda Praman. When transcendental sound is heard by a person with a pure heart, then that transcendental sound manifests its divine form. So one can realize God and all aspects of reality through Shabda Brahma, hearing transcendental sound. Gaur Premanande.